Zdravo svima još jednom. Dobrodošli u našu malu salu. Ovog puta imamo dva predavača, tako da Magdalina, Miloše iz TX servisa, možete da počnete sa vašim predavanjem, da ne trošimo puno vremena.
Thank you for joining us today. So, how many of you have heard of Keycloak? Can I see some hands?
Well.
Wow. Are you using it in your companies? Nice, nice. Did you ever have to migrate 40 million users? No hands? A bit of hands. Okay. So hopefully today we will convince you maybe to use it even more in your companies. So before we jump into that, we would like to introduce ourselves.
Hello, everyone. Is my mic working? Yes? Nope. Test, yes? Yeah, cool. Hi, everyone. My name is Milos. I am a QA tech lead at TX Services and the sub-company Doodle. I've been with Doodle for around 4 years now. During that time, I mostly specialized in the platform domains, to be specific in authentication and authorization systems, and we kind of dwelled into the performance testing here. And today we would like to present you an overview of a project I worked together with Magdalena. So I'll let her introduce herself as well.
So hello, KeepCon. My name is Magdalena, and I have been serving as tech lead at Doodle team of TX services for 3 years now. My expertise lies primarily in backend development. Milos and I have been working together for almost 4 years now, during which we have been dedicated to the core domains. Today, we're excited to present our journey with Keycloak. So, if you're thinking of using an open source identity and access management solution, we would be happy to share our experience and give you some insight into the process. If you want to get to know us even better, there will be contact information during Q&A part, so stay tuned. During this presentation, we will provide you an introduction to the framework and its architecture. We will discuss the reasons behind our choice of this particular solution, and we will share the wild journey it had taken us on. So what is this Keycloak? Keycloak is an open source identity and access management solution. It is used for authentication, user federation, and single sign-on. It supports the main authentication and authorization protocols, such as OpenID Connect, OAuth 2.0, and SAML. It has built-in customizable authentication flows, as well as admin console. The server is also built with extensibility in mind, and for that, it provides a number of service provider interfaces, each one providing a specific capability to the server, which was, in fact, essential for our use case. To give you a bit of a background, Doodle is a global scheduling company. How many of you have ever participated in a Doodle poll? Let me see some hands. Cool, great turnout. So, in the past, we depended on our own custom authentication system. As our user base expanded rapidly, that 40 million that I mentioned in the beginning, we came to the realization that our in-house solution had some issues. Extensibility in terms of identity providers, such as adding more providers as Slack or Zoom or whatnot, the problem of having single session per user approach, and matter of security and scalability of such a non-standard implementation. So it became evident that we required a more secure and standardized solution that could accommodate for our anticipated growth. The following criteria was taken into consideration when we were discussing this new solution. We were exploring the possibility of having an external data storage within our legacy system, which needed to seamlessly integrate with the new solution. In addition to the basic OAuth flows, we needed to make sure the new solution supported identity linking OAuth flows needed for the calendar connections. Additionally, for testing purposes, we needed to make sure that the solution supported being deployed to multiple staging environments. At the time, we considered multiple alternatives, including Glue, Auth0, AWS Cognito, Okta, and Keycloak. After careful consideration, we decided that Keycloak was the best option. It provided a self-hosted open source solution with no cost per user. The fact that it could be extended in Java, which is our area of expertise, only further solidified our decision. I will hand over to Milos to explain a bit more about architecture.
Thank you, Magdalena. Let's take a look at the high-level design of our system here. Our authentication system basically consists of two major components. It's Keycloak cluster, as Magdalena previously described, and InfiniSpan cluster. In this context here, InfiniSpan is used as a caching store. And basically, InfiniSpan is an open source data grid and data platform, which is also written in Java. So how did we actually achieve high availability architecture, as you can see here? We basically decoupled the storing of user session and management of the user sessions into the separate cluster. And thus, we kind of distributed the load evenly. On the other hand, still in the Keycloak cluster, we use some embedded InfiniSpan, which is used to communicate to this remote store InfiniSpan cluster here. It does so with the hot route protocol and uses the discovery service here. This is important because these two clusters, they need to be up to date on the topology of each other to better communicate. Yeah, one thing to mention as well here is that Keycloak uses Postgres database as its main database. So on the Keycloak cluster side here, we can see that we use something called distributed cache. And basically what that is when you want to cache entries, these caches get evenly distributed across all of the pods in the cluster. And this is really great for scalability since in theory, you can horizontally scale the cluster how many cache entries you get, basically. But depending on the number of cache owners here, there is some data loss possible, especially since we don't have any persistent storage attached to it, to this cache. So if Keycloak cannot find the cache entry here, basically, then it contacts the remote store and it tries to find it there. On the remote store side, we have a replicated cache configuration, basically. And that's, you know, the name says it itself. It replicates all of the cache entries across all of the pods. So this cluster as well uses something called file store here. This is basically persistent storage. So if one of the pods gets killed or leaves the cluster or gets rebooted, it, because all of the cache entries are essentially stored as well on the persistent storage, it will be hot loaded into the RAM memory on the reboot. So maybe question for you. What do you think? Is the replicated cache faster for read or for write operations? Yes. This cache configuration basically simulates database master-slave configuration. When you want to write into this kind of configuration, basically Keycloak cluster or the cache entry that needs to be written into the remote store has a pod where it writes to, and then that pod is in charge of replicating that cache entry across all of the pods. That can be a bottleneck depending on how many pods you have in that cluster. So this is why it's recommended not to have that cluster larger than 10 pods. But it's faster for read times because you have all of the data across all of the pods in the cluster. That's pretty much it. I'll hand over to Magdalena to kind of delve a bit more into Keycloak Essentials.
As previously mentioned, Keycloak server can be extended by adding custom providers. A custom provider is simply a standard jar file that contains one or more service implementations. In our system, the following providers are standing out as the most important ones. This is a highly simplified view. We obviously have more of them. So I will start with the anonymous provider, which was needed so our users could participate anonymously in Doodle polls. So this provider allowed us to issue sessions to anonymous users without storing any user information. Next, user and legacy provider enabled us to gradually integrate with Keycloak. The first Keycloak implementation was populated with data and kept in sync with the legacy system. We needed to make sure that these two instances have the exact same data. Only then we were able to switch over to Keycloak fully for all of its authentication flows. The theme provider allows us to customize the default Keycloak theme and align with Doodle designs. Scheme provider enables automated user provisioning and deprovisioning. Identity provider, related to the problem that our legacy system had, is that it contains the custom provider implementations for providers like Slack, Zoom, or Apple that are not OIDC compliant. So this provider actually allowed our users to connect these specific provider accounts through Keycloak and into our system. The Kafka provider offered support for message producing and consuming with Kafka. Now, let's jump into the journey. So, why is upgrading Keycloak necessary? We need to keep doing this because we need to stay up to date with the technology, the features, but also security, which is probably the most important for your authentication system, right? So how does an upgrade process even work? Keycloak official documentation actually provides specific instructions on how to migrate from one version to another. We started off with Keycloak 9 and moved on to Keycloak 12. During this upgrade, as well as any other, we needed to update the code-centric charts. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the people from Codecentric for making our lives easier with these set of Helm templates, which actually evolve together with Keycloak versions. So for each corresponding version of Keycloak, we have the new version of the Codecentric charts. So obviously they're used for configuration. This upgrade from 9 to 12 also required some modifications in the identity provider. And additionally, we, as part of this upgrade, we introduced the scheme provider as a new feature. Furthermore, going from 12 to 15, we had to update the method signature of the user provider to align with the changes made in the upstream. So we also had to update the Keycloak version within the scheme provider. In addition to that, we replaced the usage of lists with streams in the database access layer and also incorporated the charts from Codecentric. So here you can see that each custom provider asks for more maintenance. Let's focus more on Keycloak 18. Going from 15 to 18 was the crucial version upgrade because it involved a paradigm shift, moving away from JBoss onto Quarkus. This brought along the usual code and charge changes, but also a change in the code structure and way of deployment. Previously used JBoss CLI commands were now replaced with Quarkus configuration files. One of the major challenges for us during this upgrade process was us learning about infrastructure and having to configure and deploy the upgraded version of InfiniSpan without having any previous experience with that. I will hand over to Milos to explain how it went.
So, the fun part of performance testing and load testing the system. Before you start even considering this, you need to collect some metrics on how do you want your system to perform, actually. So, we did that. At that time, when we did the upgrade, Doodle had around 60 million of users, basically, with 7 to 8 million monthly active sessions and, let's say, 50 users per second throughput throughout the workday. So we kind of knew where we want to be at that point. And this is important because when you're designing these kind of systems, you don't want to under-design, basically, since the system won't meet the criteria, but you don't even want to over-design it because then you will lose more money than you would like. So for the load testing, we used Gatling. It's an open source tool which met our criteria at the time. It was lightweight, portable. We were easily able to implement our authentication flows with it. And for the monitoring, we used Grafana. So it's kind of important to mention here some of the metrics that we use. These are basic metrics such as CPU, RAM, JVM metrics, and thresholds for the failure rates and so on. The load testing part here, there are multiple types of load testing, basically. When you're kind of configuring the initial configurations, you do the sort of sanity smoke test. It's not very long. The data that you run against is not very large. It's just to verify that it works. But there is another type of load testing called the soak testing, where you run your system against the maximum capacity for a couple of days. What these types of tests can show us is sometimes these really small, small memory leaks can be, you know, it became more visible, and some of CPU intensive operations can also show their behavior more visible. On this QR code here, there is actually a link to a Zulip chat with the InfiniSpan community, where we kind of, because when we did run this load test, we encountered an issue, basically. And this issue is that some of these operations were actually causing our CPU starvation here. To give a bit more context, user cache entry, or whatever caching entry that you have, there is a validation property how long this cache is valid, and this is encoded in the metadata of the cache entry. On the InfiniSpan server, there is a job that runs periodically and basically checks if this information is valid. If not, it removes the cache. And Keycloak also can do this type of operation. For example, when you log out, then you want to remove the session because it's no longer valid. And as we filled up the data on our clusters, we noticed that these removal operations are taking more and more time. At some point, it actually crashed our tests. And in this chat with Zulip, this Zulip chat with the InfiniSpan community, we kind of discussed this into more details. You can check it out to see how it went. It's important maybe also to give some context here on this upgrade process. InfiniSpan versions are tightly coupled to the Keycloak versions. So in the Keycloak 15, we had the InfiniSpan 11. On the Keycloak 18, we had the InfiniSpan 13. Some of the breaking changes that they did, well, not breaking changes, but important changes, is that they changed the implementation of the default file store. On the 11, we had a single file store, which is basically, it's a well-performing file store, but it has some issues because it stores all the keys and file positions into a memory, which can then lead to out-of-memory exceptions if you run out of the memory, basically. And there are some possible fragmentation issues because it's not reusing the space after appending the values on the disk. InfiniSpan crew tried to fix this with soft index file stores, basically. And they implemented a variant of B+3, which is then cached in memory with Java soft references. That's how it got its name, actually, soft index file store. And this B+3 is called index, and then that index is basically offloaded to a persistent storage, which is how they mitigated the risk of running out of memory, basically, because it's offloaded to a file system. And this doesn't need to be persisted across the reboots because its main purpose is for offloading only. here we can see some of our metrics that we collected. Important part here is basically if you can see the purple and the red threads overlapping. The purple threads here are threads which are in state waiting, and the red ones are in the state timed waiting. And this information by itself really doesn't give you that much information, just means that at some point, you know, some thread was trying to access one cache entry and it timed out because it was blocked by other threads. So, yeah, something went wrong there, but we couldn't really tell what was going on. So we decided to start profiling the CPU and RAM memory to kind of see what was going on. And since Magdalena was actually most active there, I'll let her to dive deep into it a bit more.
Milos mentioned profiling. Profiling is a method used to detect how long each function or line of code takes to run and how often it gets executed. For this profiling, first we used the JProfiler, but this tool turned out to actually use too much memory and it crashed our pods even before we were able to record the actual reports. For this reason, we opted for Pyroscope. Pyroscope is an open source profiling tool used to instrument applications and compute flame graphs such as this one. You can see here that in the method call stack, we can see the method, the one that is in the white rectangle, that is actually it has the highest CPU. So from this, we were able to deduce that the problem was the file store implementation. Keycloak 18 is now iterating through the entire cache content when trying to retrieve a single entry. This was a change from this version, and this does not work properly with the soft index file store implementation with the recursive nodes. So I want to quote on William Burns from our InfiniSpan Zulip chat discussions, where he stated that iterating over the cache that many times with the store is not something they would normally recommend. So the non-optimal traversal through the nodes of all caches caused the high CPU usage on InfiniSpan side. I have to mention here that on Keycloak side, performance was not affected at all, besides the request timing out due to slow responses from the remote InfiniSpan cluster. I have to admit, in this moment, we were a bit desperate. There was a clear evidence that we cannot make Keycloak 18 work with InfiniSpan 13. So Milos, what was our conclusion?
Yes, what was our conclusion? Before we kind of jump into how, what was our solution and what were next steps, some of our observations on this whole process and the processes before were that definitely keeping up with versions of Keycloak can be challenging since it's open source projects and what joys it come with the open source projects. And definitely when you're starting the whole thing with the open source, it can be a steep learning curve, but as you go more and more, it becomes easier. However, we did really understood the benefits that Keycloak brings with it out of the box features, as it really sped up our development time since we had everything almost out of the box on Keycloak. It is more cost efficient to run than any other third party managed service given our user base, because it was charged based on the users you wanted to authenticate. And we can say that it is secure with regular updates since it's backed by Red Hat. So the question comes, how did we actually solve this? When you're in situations like this, sometimes you need to take a step back and kind of, this is what we literally did and try to see what if we can make it work with InfiniSpan 11. And we did. Luckily for us, Keycloak was backwards compatible with the previous version of InfiniSpan, which for our use case and the previous implementation of the file store did much better job rather than the new file store. When we look ahead, we are already planning our next steps to upgrade into the latest stable version of Keycloak, which is 22, and it uses InfiniSpan 14. Now, when we look through the community and what they did in the new version of InfiniSpan, they really did address these kind of issues. So we are really hopeful that with the next upgrade, we can make it work with that version of infinite span. Reflecting on our experience in general, working with Magdalena on these Keycloak upgrades, it enabled us to meet our platform needs without really reinventing the wheel, which is the whole point of Keycloak. You don't need to reinvent the wheel, just use the features. And it also allowed us to meet our platform need, which was our requirement from the management side. It also made us cost effective, since we host it on our infrastructure and we don't use any third-party managed service. So if you and your company have similar requirements as we did back in the days, hopefully this presentation will give you some insights if Keycloak can also be a potential solution for you. Thank you for watching. It's a question time. If you want to get me and Magdalena better, here's our QR codes to our contact cards. And yes, questions.
There's a microphone.
Yeah, there's a microphone.
Thanks. Hi. So yeah, the question will be: Keycloak comes as Kubernetes out of the box, and after all, did you have any challenges in deployment of this entire solution?
It comes with a Docker image. Basically, you have Helm charts for Keycloak, so
out of the box, pretty much.
Yeah.
Okay. Any challenges?
Yes. Some of the challenges were to actually. They have these CRDs where you basically can automate the configuration of Keycloak. That can be challenging because it's not really perfect all the times, but you know, it makes our life easier for the test.
But that is on top, basically. Yeah. Keycloak deployment is fairly simple.
Yes.
Yes.
Thanks. Yeah, just one question from me. Could you elaborate more about how many pods do you have, and how many? What's the limit of system? How many requests per second? Or?
Let's just circle back to that slide quickly. So you mean for the Keycloak or for the infinite span cluster or in general?
For both.
For both. So the limit of this architecture, basically the bottleneck would be the infinite span cluster here, since it uses the replicated cache, and then you can't really scale it that much because of the replication factor. And possible the database, since this is already pre-configured on your provider. You know, if you have an instance of database and you need to upgrade there.
And sorry, how many requests per second?
It's not limited by requests per seconds because, like I said, distributed cache can scale horizontally to accommodate that. However, the number of sessions stored in the infinite span cluster can be a bottleneck.
Thanks.
Yeah, one question from me. I noticed that you skipped several versions between two upgrades of Keycloak. Is there a reason for that?
Yes, maybe I can take this one. Well, actually, we couldn't really afford like going each version by version, but also at the time that we did upgrades, there were certain security patches that were not have not been backported in previous versions. So, for instance, that's why we had to go from 9 to 12.
And one more question. From this perspective, would you consider other solutions that they are open or?
Right now, there are other solutions out there that are also open source, but actually Keycloak works for us now. So why bother to change it? So we just need to tweak it a little bit more, but it's fine. It's working just fine.
How time consuming was initial switch to Keycloak, first implementation, and each upgrade?
That's a tough one, because we were not as involved in the initial implementation, but it was the initial one was actually used for token generation only, so that one was fairly easy. But the one where we migrated the 40 million users, I would say, I don't know, 6 months or so. And every upgrade process is not that long. So these like from 9 to 12 or 12 to 15, maybe a couple of months, even less. But the one from 15 to 18, where there was a paradigm change, I think it took a year, but there was only two of us, so
yeah, you have to take
into
consideration.
In
if you
and
have
we
larger
were not
team,
dedicated only to that.
Yeah, so yeah. You have a larger team, probably faster, much faster. Okay, thank you all for coming.